BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Two years I've had it, you know? And I bought a hammer for the outside. So I'm chilling my hammock while I punch my bag. Yeah, but it's all good therapy.
This is Kat taking out her aggressions on a bright red punch bag hanging in the corner of her tidy living room in the end terrace house she lives in just outside Cardiff. She is a tough cookie, but hasn't always been in such a good place.
How often do you do this?
Maybe twice a week. Should do it more, but maybe just twice a week.
Do you find it helpful?
Yeah, it is. Massively helpful. It gets all the aggression out. So, yeah, it's good.
With her hair pulled back in a ponytail, no makeup and denim shorts with leggings, she looks younger than her 36 years. She's slowly coming to terms with what happened to her as a teenager. When she talks about it, the damage is obvious.
I just went along with her demands, so I'd stop seeing my friends. I'd just do what she wanted me to do. I've been in dark places, I've been on antidepressants, I've self-harming, all sorts. But I just lived with her, carried on.
Kat's one of a small but growing number of people to report being sexually abused by a woman. She'd known her abuser since she was seven. Her parents were divorced and her dad, a coach driver, worked away a lot. Debbie was a convenient, though maybe not entirely suitable, babysitter.
She was funny back then. She was a drinker still. So she just used to get drunk and, I don't know, just make us laugh. And yeah, we had some good times when I was young. She was all right.
As Kat grew up, the two didn't see each other for a couple of years until Kat's dad bumped into Debbie by chance. Kat was 15 by then. Debbie, who was 27, became a regular visitor. First, she was her dad's drinking buddy, but gradually her focus turned to Kat. The family home back then was like a youth centre, Kat says. Her friends always welcome, the house never quiet. Kat started to wish things with Debbie were more like when she was much younger and she had Debbie's attention to herself.
I wanted to feel that little special connection with her, like a family bond. So I tried explaining to her that I wanted to just be that little bit more special to her. So it was at that point then, when she tried to kiss me, I pulled back and was like, what are you doing? And she was like, well, kiss me then. I said, no, I don't mean like that. And then from that point then, it just got worse and worse and worse. And, you know, basically, if I wanted her in my life, I had to give her what she wanted. And at this point, I was excited to have her back in my life, but then thinking, this is not what I wanted.
How much did her demands progress from just kissing?
Quite a lot and quite rapidly. And I remember specifically saying to her, no, I don't want to. And she just ignored me. She didn't say anything. She just continued to do what she wanted to do.
It became increasingly intense and unbearable.
It was constant, constant. Like when it had finished, I'd have to wait for permission to go and wash. It's just part of her control again. So even then, she knew. She must have known I hated it. It'd only be a few minutes, but it felt like a lifetime. You know, in that situation, when you just want to get out of there, it feels a lot longer than it probably is.
By this time, Debbie had infiltrated her way into every corner of Kat's life. Her dad thought Debbie was helping out with his teenage daughter. She was the trusted adult the school would ring if there were any problems. More of a guardian figure than anything else. Kat endured the abuse for 5 months, until one day she broke down at school. A teacher persuaded her to tell her what was wrong.
I remember her saying to me, you're an abused child. And I just cried, because I didn't think of it like that before. I'd never thought of it like that. But yeah, those words will stick with me. She was like, you're an abused child. And then by dinner time, there was social services were there. And then I panicked then because my dad's going to find out. I remember being sat in the living room. There was my dad, Debbie and me. And I remember Debbie saying, thanks a lot. Now I'm going to be labelled as a kiddie fiddler.
This was 21 years ago. Hard to believe now, but no one ever mentioned involving the police. The abuse stopped. Debbie never came to the house again. Experiences like Kat's are rare, but not as rare as you might imagine. We wanted a true picture of the extent of sexual abuse carried out by women. So we sent Freedom of Information requests to all 45 police forces in the UK to ask how many reports of sexual offences were by women. Scotland and Northern Ireland said collating this information would take too long. But 36 forces in England and Wales were able to provide data. Between those forces, there were a total of over 10,400 reports between 2015 and 2019. That's an average of more than 2,000 a year. Our figures show some of the offences reported were against older children. Over 5,400 were aged between 11 and 17. Around 3,800 reports involved victims under 11. Some forces didn't provide ages, they said, due to the potential identification of victims. Some reports involved multiple offences against the same children. The data gives new insight into the extent of sexual abuse by women. We showed the figures to psychotherapist Catherine Cox from the support organisation Survivors UK and asked her what those 10,400 reports about women abusing told her.
This is a significant figure, and what it shows is this is a phenomenon. This figure really belies the myth that female perpetrated sexual abuse doesn't happen. It clearly does, and the figures show that.
Analysis of our figures shows over a five-year period, there was a steady increase in reports of child sexual abuse by women, with 1,249 reports made in 2015, rising to 2,297 in 2019. That's an 84% increase. It may well be due to better reporting and a growing awareness.
If we think about each one of those figures is a human life, each one of those figures is somebody whose life has been massively affected by the sexual abuse that they experienced. And then we're talking about the impact on someone's life going forward, the impact of trauma on somebody's life as they move into adulthood, on their relationships, on their ability to manage their feelings, on their mental well-being, on their ability to work and so on.
Cases making the headlines are usually at the extreme end of the spectrum, like the nursery worker Vanessa George, convicted nearly 12 years ago of abusing children in her care. Our data shows there's a range of offences by women, including 382 rapes. The most common offence was sexual activity with a child. The second was sexual assault. Both offences were reported more than 2,600 times each. The figures are still tiny compared with those involving men. And that's reflected in convictions. According to the Ministry of Justice, in 2018, 98% of those found guilty of child sexual abuse were male. There were just 66 convictions of female abusers.
This is a huge red brick building on a busy junction in South London. It looks like it could be owned by a major corporation, but it's actually rented out to different charities. And one of those is the National Association for People Abused in Childhood. Its chief executive is Gabrielle Shaw, and I'm going in to meet her now.
Hello.
Good morning.
Hi, I'm Gabrielle. I'm the chief executive of NAPED.
Lovely to meet you, Gabrielle. I'm Melanie. Melanie Abbott.
Lovely to meet you.
It's very quiet out there today. I guess it's not usually like this.
No, it's very, very quiet. A lot of people still working from home, so yes.
But this is where it all happens.
On the whole floor of this building are only Gabrielle and two colleagues. From here, they help run a busy support line based in Stockport.
Yeah, we've just got those eight desks of that, and we collaborate with other charities around.
From the calls they're receiving, although most abuse is carried out by men, a small but growing number of calls are about abuse by women. And it's often in the family.
You've got a double whammy from the part of the victim and the survivor, in that not only were they betrayed by the abuse happening when they were so vulnerable, but you've got the issue of belief, because it's very hard for anybody to think that a woman, a mother, could harm their child physically, sexually, emotionally, but it does happen, and that's why it is so difficult for our victims and survivors who call us to actually say that out loud.
Shame is often an issue that's involved when you have been abused. Is that worse when it is
a woman when it is someone who you have expected to protect you?
Absolutely correct. Shame and guilt are very, very strong aspects of the experience that we hear about from abuse survivors at the hand of female perpetrators. And what we hear is that survivors suffer because they love, actually, some aspects of them. Sometimes their mother or a female abuser can be very kind, very caring, but then they'll switch. So their shame and the guilt and the confusion over, well, I love her, I love some parts of this, but then she abuses me, and they struggle to make sense of that. So the impacts, and that's why we say the traumatic impacts, can often be lifelong.
Gabrielle Shaw has a good sense of what's happening from the victims she meets, but data and formal research is scant, one reason we made our Freedom of Information request. We have discovered one researcher who's been looking at this for the last 17 years. Andrea Darling is from Durham University, and she's also worked for the ongoing independent inquiry into child sexual abuse. She's found when women sexually abuse, particularly an adolescent boy, it's often minimised. She believes much goes unreported, leaving victims with no help and no justice.
Underreporting is a particular problem in relation to children and young people who experience sexual abuse perpetrated by women. And I think there are a number of reasons for that. I think victims and survivors have talked about that additional layer and level of difficulty in being able to disclose and then having been disbelieved. And I think that's basically, that comes down to social and societal and cultural perceptions of women, women as perpetrators, women's sexuality. And I think that has an impact on children, young people being able to report this type of abuse.
Back when Kat was 15, the police were kept out of the picture. Debbie was allowed to carry on with her life. But 18 years after it all happened, Kat realised she couldn't allow her abuser to continue as if nothing had gone on. She emailed South Wales Police with just a tentative question asking about reporting sexual abuse. The very next day, the police arranged to visit her at home, and eventually, she told them the whole story.
It took a few weeks, maybe 3 or 4 weeks, to get my statement finished. That was quite hard at times. But again, the police officer was just amazing. He was like understanding of how hard it was for me to say some things. And I almost tried to skirt around actually saying certain words. And he was like, Kat, you need to describe, you know, how it happened and what happened. And I had to go into real detail with him, and that was hard. But he was lovely.
What was hard about it?
Just the fact that I had to go into such details, because I'd never told anyone these details. Just having to tell a stranger that. But all the while thinking, well, it's out now. I've started the ball rolling. There's no going back. I have to just keep doing it. It has to just keep spilling out.
Kat documented what was going on at the time in diaries and unsent letters. She kept them, and they're still emotional to read.
Dear Debbie, you know now, don't you? You know I don't blame myself anymore. You know I'm not scared of you anymore. You know, I know, you're a paedophile. I'm so angry. You've messed me up bad. I'm not sure I'll ever be the person I was, the person I should be, because of you. I mask my pain, but one day you're going to need a mask. I look forward to the day the shadows come for your soul. Rest in hell.
The letters and diaries proved to be vital evidence, which meant her abuser, Debbie Evans, was sentenced in 2018 to 7 years in prison for 11 counts of indecent assault.
Never once did I think it'd end up jail. Never once did I think that far ahead. The fact that the police had believed me and arrested her was just amazing. That in itself was just massive to me. So then every stage after that was just bigger and bigger and bigger.
What about now? How do you feel now about everything that's happened?
I feel a lot lighter now. I feel like the dark shadow that's been following me majority of my life has now left. It's not all sunshine and rainbows, I'm not going to lie, but I don't have as many dark days, I don't have as many dark thoughts. I don't blame myself anymore. She obviously took advantage of her position in my life, because she knew I'd do what she'd say, because she had that mother authority. I didn't call her mum by any means, but she was the first female adult as such to look after me and to take that role after I left my mum.
Do you think that you were being groomed by Debbie?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Because she knew I trusted her. She knew I loved her. Not in a weird way, but she knew I respected her. And she knew she had that authority over me. Yeah, I definitely, definitely think I was groomed.
And the first time you spoke to the police, was it particularly hard because of embarrassment or because you wondered if they'd believe you?
Both. But the truth always prevails, doesn't it? The truth always comes out.
I'm Mark Lewis. I'm a detective superintendent at South Wales Police. So my role is strategic oversight of all areas of vulnerability, which includes child sexual abuse and rape.
Police are grappling with the difficulty of getting people to come forward about any kind of sexual offence. But in South Wales, those who dealt with Kat's case recognise different factors come into play when the sexual abuse is by a woman.
It is probably a taboo element in reporting those offences in the first place. I think it will be difficult for those victims to come forward. So inevitably, there'll be a delay in them coming forward. The stigma that may come in reporting those types of offences for female victims, I would guess, would be quite enormous. And so to overcome that initial concern is significant for a victim. So obviously that's down to the police, down to support agencies to keep trying to give that reassurance to victims to report regardless of their circumstances.
Is there a danger, because women are seen generally by society as less predatory, if you like, that clues that would be picked up if a man were behaving that way, like friending someone on social media or sending text messages, are missed or overlooked or not taken as seriously?
I think that's a reasonable observation. I think knowledge around offender behaviour is probably further developed in relation to males, and probably more learning needs to be gleaned around female perpetrators. I think that's a fair comment. Because, yeah, there can be confusion about what is fair and caring, attentive behaviour, and where does that tip over into being grooming.
The body representing all heads of police in the UK, the National Police Chiefs Council, told us they recognise the number of incidents reported doesn't represent the true scale of the problem. But they say recently they've significantly improved their response to protecting children and ensuring people have the confidence to come forward, regardless of whether the abuser is male or female. There isn't much research into this area, but Andrea Darling from Durham University has looked at the cases of 40 male and female teachers who sexually abused students. She says her work shows alarm bells would ring about a man sending texts or spending excessive time with a child, but might not if it's a woman.
There is a lack of understanding of the extent to which this abuse can happen, and that means that potentially abusive behaviour that may have been picked up if the perpetrator had been a male adult versus a child is explained away or is not viewed in the same type of context when the perpetrator is a female. And I've seen that consistently throughout my research, where early warning signs are not responded to appropriately.
In some scenarios, like when a teenage boy is abused by a young woman, that abuse might not be taken seriously, even in the criminal justice system. What 15-year-old schoolboy would turn down such an attractive offer? Asked one judge in a court case about a pupil abused by a teacher back in 2017. Gabriel Shaw from the National Association for People Abused in Childhood says these attitudes are unhelpful, but not uncommon.
There's almost this myth out there, or this salaciousness of a view which says, oh, you know, he got on with your teacher and she's fit, or especially if the perpetrator is a young, attractive female. And that takes no account of that shame, that guilt, that confusion, the impacts that abuse has had on that male victim, if that was the case. And I think as a society more generally, we need to take this more seriously. Abuse can be very, very traumatic no matter what the setting, and it doesn't help to laugh at or diminish or try and think, well, that wasn't really abuse, it was just an early start, good on him. It can affect people in very different ways.
Figures from the Office of National Statistics show around 4% of child sexual abusers are women, but this is based on reports to the police. There's evidence more women abusers are being flagged when applying for jobs with children or vulnerable adults than are being reported to the police. We made a separate Freedom of Information request to the Disclosure and Barring Service for England and Wales. It records complaints of inappropriate sexual behaviour, not just convictions. If a complaint's upheld, you'll be banned from working with children. Figures for the last full year show nearly a quarter of those referred to the service were women. That's almost 12,000 in total, and nearly 2,000 more than the number of reports to police over a five-year period to 2019. The teaching regulators told us they are committed to protecting the public and do consider all information to carry out as many safeguards as possible. The Disclosure and Barring Service said there will always be a level of uncertainty. A holistic, evidence-based safeguarding approach is more likely to mitigate the risks. The organisation dealing with this in Scotland told us it will ask police for any relevant information when looking at people applying for sensitive roles. The times are changing. One of the BBC's most popular soap operas, EastEnders, has a storyline highlighting female sexual offenders.
I was only little, I was only 12.
What did she do, Mick?
I was just a child.
Do you want to tell me what she did?
She abused me.
The character Mick Carter, played by Danny Dyer, has a difficult relationship with his partner. One reason, the sexual abuse inflicted by his female care worker when he was 12. The organisation Survivors UK, which caters for men, boys and non-binary people, advised the programme producers. And Danny Dyer met some of those who've used their helpline and counselling service. Just like the EastEnders character, those contacting Survivors UK wait, on average, for 26 years before talking about their abuse. And then, not to the police. Catherine Cox is a psychotherapist from Survivors UK and helps run the counselling service and helpline.
None of the men that I have met at Survivors UK have reported that abuse to the criminal justice system.
None at all?
None at all, no.
That's quite shocking. Why do they say that is?
I think there's a societal expectation, myth, that it's men who perpetrate abuse and women who are the victims of abuse. So it's difficult enough, I think, for men to come forward anyway, because the expectation societally is that it's women who are the victims of abuse or survivors of abuse. But I think additionally, the idea that a man can be abused by a woman is really difficult for others to comprehend, including the survivor themselves, because there's a thought, well, women can't abuse, or women wouldn't abuse as well. I think we have a need, a sort of gendered need, to see women as protectors, as caregivers, as benign. And the idea that women can sexually abuse is going against that sort of hope expectation. And I think for a male survivor of female perpetrated abuse, the reality of getting a conviction is usually going to be extremely low.
Catherine says the years it takes to talk about such a traumatic event inevitably have an effect.
We see men who were abused as children, and then there are decades of compounding impact as a result of that abuse. So we talk about survival coping strategies. We develop, all of us develop survival coping strategies if we are psychologically overwhelmed. And those survival coping strategies might be isolation. They might be dependence on recreational drugs or alcohol, which are used in a type of self-medicating way. Real difficulties around relationships of all sorts, including sexual relationships. People who have had to not only cope with the impact of the abuse itself, but the compounding impact of that abuse through their lives.
This is certainly the case with one man I spoke to. His words are spoken by an actor to protect his identity. We're calling him David. For many years, he told no one about what happened when he was 8 years old.
My babysitter was a woman in her 20s, I think. Well, she was fun, and we enjoyed the babysitter. But after she put my younger brothers to bed, she would come into my bedroom. There wasn't a lot of warmth coming from Mum and Dad at the time. And yet, well, here is a person who was giving me a lot of what looked like affection. So it began when I was 8 and carried on until we left that house 2 years later. All children want to stay up late, and so she would come in my room and I got to stay up an extra, you know, maybe an hour, I don't know, and we would play games in the bedroom and I got a lot of attention. So two things that children crave, staying up late, being a bit naughty, and getting lots of attention from an adult. But it wasn't affection, it was abuse. Let's be absolutely clear, I know that. But I'm saying what it felt like to an 8-year-old was someone taking a special interest in you, doing special things for you and with you.
He believes the abuse affected all his relationships and actions in adult life in complex and insidious ways. He developed a pornography habit. He says because he was searching for answers to inform his past experiences.
I found there is a part of this website with stories about teen boys with older women, and then I thought, oh, I know what that's about. So I downloaded some of those, and then I was reading them. It almost felt like affection again. It felt like going back to when I was 8 years old, and there was a woman who was actually taking an interest in me and willing to spend time with me. I know that is a horrible way to look back at your own abuse, but that's what it was feeling like, sitting there in an evening looking at those comics.
There were other pornographic drawings and images too, hundreds in total. When it all came out,
I was made to leave the house immediately, and I was told that I had to have restrictions on seeing my own children. I just have to pause for a moment. It was devastating. The implication is I could end up with longer-term restrictions on being around my children.
He pleaded guilty and accepts this is a serious criminal offence and has been undergoing therapy. He thinks there'll be many others who need that kind of help.
I'm afraid that there's other men out there who are underplaying what happened to them and how corrosive it has been in their lives and how they are maybe doing activities that are inappropriate or acting out. And I want them to get help, re-examine what happened to them and maybe think it was more serious than they might have thought, particularly if there's a woman involved. Society has told people for so long that it's not a bad thing for older women to do this.
Survivors UK believes there's no link between being abused and going on to commit offences. But many do need support for decades to navigate the trauma of keeping their secrets for so long. The lack of legal recourse for some young people, the stigma of admitting sexual abuse by a woman, the fear of not being believed, all contribute to many of these offences never being reported. This, of course, means victims are failed. But it also means offenders don't get the treatment, which could turn their lives around. Sophie Benedict is a forensic psychotherapist who worked with women at Holloway Prison until it closed in 2016, and now, via a charity she and other psychotherapists established. In the 15 years she's been doing this work, there hasn't been a specific therapeutic programme for women. Instead, she's adapted a male one, despite the fact it's not always ideal.
Well, despite the increase in numbers of female sex offenders, it perhaps does reflect that we are less willing to offer this group rehabilitation. It's something as a society that is perhaps easier to keep out of sight and out of mind. It's very toxic to think about females who offend in this way. Of course, there are groups that are pushing for more development and more research, but it in a way mirrors society and the criminal justice system's rejection of this criminality, because it's very hard for us to bear and for us to stomach.
Are you saying then at the moment there just isn't enough known about female sex offenders' motivation and so on to design a specific programme?
There's still sort of so much to be understood about sexual deviance in females, but they are different types of offenders compared to their male counterparts. if we want to rehabilitate these kind of offenders, we need to continue to invest in and develop the models and programs that can kind of effectively focus on this offending behavior, which takes enormous effort, and it needs to happen during incarceration and then post-release. I think it's commonly a lifelong project.
The Ministry of Justice told us many female child sexual abusers don't need specific interventions, but more holistic services, which address things like trauma, mental health and substance abuse. The Scottish Government is currently undertaking work to ensure its rehabilitation programmes do reflect the current nature of sexual offending. And in Northern Ireland, the Justice Department told us only a very small number of women are in custody for sexual offences, and they're all offered a detailed assessment to work out the best kind of intervention. The Westminster Government has promised what it describes as a new first-of-its-kind strategy to tackle all forms of child sexual abuse, including that perpetrated by female offenders. But it couldn't give us a date when this will happen.
So we're currently standing in the lighthouse. We're standing in the reception area of the lighthouse, and the lighthouse is a service.
This is the Lighthouse Centre in North London, a joint project with input from the NHS, the NSPCC and others. It's the kind of one-stop shop the charity wants to see everywhere, so children can give their evidence just the once. After sanitising my hands and checking I'm COVID safe, Emma Harewood, the manager, shows me round.
So we're just walking, first of all, into the downstairs part of the building. This might be one of the first places that children come to. It's where we record the interview for the police, called the video recorded interview.
If you go in, I'll follow. We'll keep 2 metres apart.
Okay. So this one's lovely. We've had this beautifully designed kind of tree of lights in the corner with lots of hanging pendant lights, separate chairs with sides around them to make people feel a little bit more secure. And then, as you saw, the great wicker hanging chair that they love to spin in and always wish they could take home with them.
The centre's based on an idea pioneered in Iceland more than 20 years ago, which saw conviction rates for child sexual abuse double. As we look around, Emma explains children can record their evidence for trial, and police, social workers, doctors and therapists can see them under one roof. People like Kat and David took years to talk about what happened to them. Emma says it's hoped children here can be supported to talk to the authorities more quickly.
I guess the sooner the children can report after the incident, the less likely they will progress onto other mental health conditions, sometimes even post-traumatic stress disorder. There are studies that show if you intervene within 4 to 6 weeks of the traumatic event happening, or the first time a child discloses, you can really prevent progression onto some of the most complex mental health problems. But also, if it happens closer to the time, I guess there's a better chance of a child being able to remember and share the detail of what happened, which should help with a future conviction.
Emma Harewood would like to see centres like this throughout the UK. Scotland has announced plans for a similar one, but it won't be ready until later this year. The Home Office told us after evaluating the Lighthouse, it will consider how other areas can establish similar centres. Andrea Darling says her studies show this kind of support is vital.
I think it's fundamentally important that we understand a lot more of what is happening in relation to this type of child sexual abuse in terms of being able to prevent this type of abuse from happening in the first place, but also in terms of supporting any victims and survivors who have experienced this type of abuse, either recently or non-recently, and in terms of the way that we respond to them appropriately and help them to deal with the consequences that can follow from being sexually abused by a woman.
I bought that in Spain. That was around the court case because they had that specially made. Strength doesn't come from what you can do, it comes from overcoming the things you once thought you couldn't. I thought that was very apt.
Back at her home in Cardiff, Kat is still working on the process of building herself back up. By waiving her anonymity, she hopes others will be persuaded to come forward and report crimes which may have been hidden for too long. She doesn't want other teenagers in the position she was, waiting almost 2 decades before speaking to the police. She still has tough days, but they're becoming fewer. Seeing her abuser jailed represents justice and closure.
It means I can just be me again. I live now, I don't just exist. Whereas before I was just existing, I didn't look forward to days, I didn't plan ahead. And living with like suicidal thoughts all the time, that can be draining. I don't have any of that anymore. Justice was served. She's paying the price for what she did.
Does it worry you that there may have been other victims, though?
Yeah, it does. But now I know there won't be, because she's on the register for life, so that'll always follow her, even when the sentence is finished. So I feel like I've done my bit in trying to protect kids from her.
This File on 4 podcast is a Radio Current Affairs production for BBC Sounds. It was presented by Melanie Abbott and produced by Helen Clifton. Don't forget, you can find more radio, music and podcasts on BBC Sounds.